AI agents are popping up everywhere, from smart assistants to autonomous research tools to self-driving cars. But what actually makes these things tick? In this video, we're going to break down the anatomy of an AI agent. We'll peel back the layers, sensing, thinking, and acting, to show how data from the real world turns into decisions and then is translated back out as actions. So now let's take a look at how all of these things work together. So we'll start with the sensing part of the agent. The agent has to get some information in. This is basically its perception. Just like a person has eyes and ears and we perceive through those senses. Well, if we're talking about an AI agent, how does it get information in? Well, one of the ways that it gets information in is through text. It could be natural language processing. If we're talking about a chatbot, that information just gets typed in and it takes that into its processing. It could also be some sort of sensor. So in this case, there could be a vision sensor, a camera, it could be a microphone, something along those lines that brings in information from the outside world. It could be APIs that are, or other types of events that are being triggered that are input into this system as well. So these are just a few examples of the inputs that go into the system. So then it moves over to a thinking stage. How do I process all of this? Well, it turns out in doing that, I need some more context. So one of the things I'm going to add to this system is a knowledge base of some sort. In that knowledge base, I'm going to store things like facts, things that are important to this system that it needs to know, rules that it needs to operate with. It could also have some other information that gives it context. So these kinds of things are going to go into the thinking process. Other sorts of information that could be important, and by the way, these could come from a database, these could come from a RAG source, a retrieval augmented generation source, so there could be a lot of different sources for this knowledge coming into the system. Another source that we need to consider here is some sort of policy information. So we may have a situation where I have goals that I need to consider. What is it I want the system to be able to do? Particular objectives and things of that sort. I may have priorities that I need it to consider. All of those things go into the thought process as well. We don't want it to make decisions without considering the facts, the rules, the goals, objectives, the priorities, all of that kind of stuff. Then we get into the reasoning part of all of this. Here is where we're going to start dealing with things like if, then, else kind of logic. So here we're processing all of that information, thinking about it, doing planning. So we're looking at what do I need to do and how am I going to go about doing it? And in these cases, I'm going to also need to decompose tasks. So if I know that I have a big high-level goal that I want to accomplish, well, one of the things I have to do is break that down into smaller components. So I need to do task decomposition. I'm also going to leverage things like machine learning, where the system is learning through reinforcement, or it could be learning through showing it lots of different things and it develops a pattern. So it sees these things, we keep showing it more and more of the same type of data, more and more of certain types of objects if we're using a sensor, and then it starts to develop an idea as to what those things are, what are the characteristics that go with that. Then we use something like a large language model technology and leverage that, again, for some of these things like the text inputs and things of that sort, chain of thought reasoning, all of this. So here's the thinking part, the reasoning part of this system. Next, we're going to move to the generative part, the action. Here we're going to generate certain types of output. We could generate text as an output. We could generate speech. We could generate alerts. We could generate video, all kinds of things like that. The action might also be to read or write to a database. So this is a possibility as well. We may also execute some level of control. So maybe we have actuators because we're wanting to operate on the real world. Maybe I have some sort of robotic system or a self-driving car where all of this, once these decisions have been made, now I'm going to operate on the system. So maybe in the case of a robotic car or a self-driving car, I've taken in information from sensors, I've considered the facts, I've considered the goals, I've run it through my reasoning logic, and then I interface through an actuator in order to affect the way that the system actually works. And another really important part of all of this is a feedback loop. So I want to make sure that it's constantly evaluating its own performance. We want to evaluate the outputs of the system and make sure that they're achieving, in fact, what we intended. Do they match the goals that we had in mind? The term that we use here is reinforcement learning with human feedback. So this is basically where we give it a thumbs up or thumbs down. Sometimes the system is getting its own feedback by trying an action and then seeing, did that get us closer to the goal or did it take it further away from the goal? So we can do some of these kinds of course corrections on its own, or we can override and create the course corrections ourselves. This is the basic anatomy of an AI agent. Okay, now let's take this anatomy that we just described in the abstract and take a real example. So let's say I want to book travel reservations for a trip that's upcoming. So what do I need to put into the system? What does it need to start with? Well, it needs to know what dates of travel, you know, when am I going and when am I coming back? It needs to know the destination, where am I going? So there might be other things, but we'll take those as input. So that's the sensory perception part of this. And I would probably enter that into a chatbot, or maybe it's smart enough to read it off of my calendar and see that. That goes into the reasoning portion. But the reasoning portion, again, needs more context. So we're going to go up here to the knowledge base. In this knowledge base, I would have already stored some preferences that I have. Maybe there's certain airlines that I prefer, maybe certain hotels that I like to stay in. It could also be based upon the location, where maybe I like a particular hotel chain, but maybe it's going to depend on the particular city, which one of those hotels I'm going to actually have it choose. So where is the event that I'm going to be going to speak at, for instance, if I'm speaking at a conference? Well, then I'd like the hotel maybe to be close to that. But I also run every day. So I want to have a hotel that's in a place where I can go for a decent run. So that's another kind of preference that would be built into the system, be very personal to me. Now, some other information that wouldn't be personal to me would be things like maps. So the system should know where all these different things are located. It needs to know prices for the different things that it might book. It needs to know availability for flights and hotels and things of that sort. So all of this knowledge base it could look up, and that's going to be important to feed into the decision-making logic. Another thing we have to consider, hey, look, I'm traveling on business, so I have to follow IBM's business guidelines and do what is going with the policy. So they're going to have some limits or some caps on, in the particular city, you can spend this much on a hotel, but not more. Or here is a particular preferred travel partner, and we want you to book with those, if that's what we're considering. So these would be policy issues that are also added in to the decision-making process. Once I've gone through all of that, then the reasoning goes through, and it looks at all of the things that are here, and it then figures out what is the best way to satisfy this request. And ultimately, it's going to go out to the action portion, which is going to book the reservation. And it's going to book this by going off and talking to the airline reservation system, the hotel reservation system, and a number of other different things. And after it's done all those things, it's going to give me the input. I'm going to have the electronic ticket and the reservation and all of this kind of stuff. So this is it acting on in the external world and accomplishing the task ultimately. Okay, so all of this is great, I think, but we need to go back and talk about the feedback loop. So it's going to ask me some sort of survey, for instance, after it's all done. How did I do? Did I meet your needs or not? And I'm going to give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down. So here's the reinforcement with the reinforcement learning with human feedback type of thing. It could also go back and evaluate some of these things on its own and say, well, I came up with this answer, but I'm going to double check myself and see how well did I match these things. Maybe even try a couple of other scenarios on my own as hypotheticals. And it could operate on that. And again, keep tuning itself, keep getting better, keep getting smarter, keep getting more personalized and more effective at doing what is otherwise a relatively complicated task to accomplish. Now I hope you not only understand how AI agents work, but also how powerful they can be, and the amazing potential they possess to improve speed and efficiency, freeing you up to do the things you do best, and leaving the gorpy details to your AI agent.